The work schedule of our one full-time ACO position right now is a 40-hour work week for a labor contract. Two day shifts per week, 7 a.m. to 3 p.m., 2 day shifts, 3 p.m. to 11 p.m. At that rate, that's 40 hours per week. There are 120 hours of time between 7 a.m. and 11 p.m., 7 days a week. So the police officers are currently handling 80% two-thirds of that effort, 80 hours per week. The ACO is handling 40 hours of that 120-hour schedule from 7 a.m. to 11 p.m., Monday through Sunday. So we already have less than one-third of the work week. Do we have an ACO available? The rest of two-thirds of the week, we have police officers performing the same virtually the same function. So if the full-time ACO work less than 30% of the day shifts per week throughout the year, 130 shifts, based on time off, vacation, personal, sick leave, holidays, it results in a net result of 106 shifts, day shifts per year that the full-time ACO is available to us. Police cover the balance of 71% of the time, day shift, 7 a.m. to 3 p.m., because we don't staff beyond the full-time ACO. Our lease law ordinance is in effect from 7 a.m. to 4 p.m. So you see, 30% of the time, essentially, we have a ACO on duty to respond to those lease law violations. 71% of the time, it's police officers that are on duty to respond to lease law violations. Over a 12-month period, doing an exhaustive analysis month to month to month, I've had to make some judgments, but some of them are fairly self-explanatory when you look at the records. Dog bites, I'll start at the bottom. Total 12-month activity for the animal control officer in terms of complete responses, 364 responses in that period of time. Total 12-month activity for police officers for animal control purposes, 341 responses, about 50-50. I broke it down to what I consider to be core services that are central law, public safety enforcement or animal control management functions. And this is obviously something that can be debated because I'm not an animal control person, so I don't know if it's new to you with my dog. So I don't know whether some of this other activity part of the core service, but I don't think so. I'll tell you why. So what I found was that in that 12-month period, there were 15 dog bites that ACO responded to. There were 36 leash law enforcement cases identified in the records as leash law enforcement. There were 8 barking dogs, and there were no animal cruelty. So it was for a 12-month period, there were 5 per month. There was 59 core service responses required by our ACO. Police, based on that, responded to 4 dog bites, 24 leash law enforcement incidents, 16 barking dogs and nuisances, and 4 animal cruelty calls. So they responded to 46 core service incidents, or about 4 per month. Obviously, they've got 14 police officers, although spread out for a second and third shift, but you have numerous people, so that's a variety of different individuals doing 46 responses as opposed to one ACO doing 59 responses. So it's just occasional work that all the daytime officers get involved with individually handling ACO functions. Then what constitutes the bulk of activity in the animal control function is what amounts to all this other service activity. 305 on the ACO's part, 295 on the police officer's part. We have a service that appears in Jamestown. We have a fairly liberal standard for what types of service the animal control officer or police officer is acting in the guise of the animal control department provides to the citizens of Jamestown. and it's makes, I will acknowledge, it certainly makes Jamestown a small town, a community, and has that major kind of feel to it. But the type of service that really is not provided in a lot of the other communities because they can't afford it. What this is that if you read the records, Mrs. Jones will call up and say, "I just lost my dog, he ran out of my yard." And dispatch will report that as a incident, and it goes into the records. And the ACO or a police officer might pick that up, and they'll say, "Okay, we'll be on lookout." So that gets reported as a service response. Then Mrs. Smith will call and say, "My dog came home." That gets reported, "Dog came home." It didn't require any physical action on the part of anybody. It was just a communication back and forth. Wonderful service for the community to have that type of dialogue between the residents and the police department and the animal control officer that we will be on the lookout. So if we see your dog, you know, we'll call back to dispatch and then they call the homeowner back and say, "The dog is at such and such a location," and they can go help them. They can pick him up. Or the police officer as well as the ACO will actually provide service. They'll pick up the animal and they will take them to Mrs. Smith's house. No leash law violation assessed against the individual. It's just a community service. And what I'm alleging is that that's a very expensive service, you know, for us to provide. But it's a community choice as to whether or not the community wants to make that expenditure. And so all these lost dogs, and I will acknowledge also cats, because this is a small community and people are neighbors and they know each other, people will call and say, "My cat is lost." Well, I never knew if a cat ever got lost. Cat always knows where it wants to go. They'll find their way home. Or you put in most communities, the telephone poles are the litmus test for finding lost cats. It's not the community that gets involved. Through paid service. Roadkill is a, and I'll back up for a second, and none of this is meant to cast any aspersions or be a critical judgment about our ACO. It's not a performance review or a performance assessment. These actually are duties that are listed in the job description. So it's not as though our ACO is going out beyond the bounds of the job description. If I were a ACO officer in Jamestown, I would say, "Oh, I guess I'm supposed to pick up lost dogs," because that's what they do here. But it's not a function that is repeated in a lot of the different cities and towns across the state. Removing roadkill, that's part of the ACO's job description. You see the police are not required to handle dead animals. Our DPW department, however, obviously only working 40 hours a week, working 40 hours a week. There's a lot of roadkill that happens during the other balance of the week. What happens? Either nobody notices it until the ACO comes on, or TBW picks up roadkill routinely and removes it and actually notices of it at the transfer station in the rest of the garbage. That, by the way, that's where a lot of roadkill. Then there is a wild animal complaint, and as we all know, in southern Rhode Island and in the rural area of the state, you have human skunks, eating birds and bats and different animals that are kind of nuisances that you don't want to have around. People call and say, "I've seen a raccoon sighting, I think it might be acting strangely." We'll send out a respondent. Now that is a DEM public. Again, the job description does say that our ACO does respond to wild animal complaints. So our ACO has to be important to that job description. You can see the police do that as well. What happens, I would say 90% of the time, the animal's gone. No sighting. Obviously, they're just roaming around and they're involved in it. In other cases, if there is a rabid animal that truly appears to be public safety and health hazard, our police officers have the ability to euthanize them on the spot if we see them. So that's where you really need public safety.